Ladies and gentlemen, welcome once again to the Hindu Lit for Life 2019. Let's begin our first session for the day. Dravidian Ideology in Praxis, Homage to Kalaignar Karunanidhi. Participating in this discussion are Dr. N. Ezhilan, Kanimozhi Karunanidhi, and N. Ram. Please welcome them on stage with a huge round of applause. Dr. Ezhilan, consultant physician at Kaveri Hospital and Ashwini Soundra Hospital in Chennai, hails from a family of freedom fighters and was himself at the forefront of student protests during his college days. He has been running a clinic for the poor and needy from 2004 and has traveled across Tamil Nadu to raise awareness of the genocide of Tamils in Sri Lanka. Our next panelist is poet, journalist and politician, Ms. Kanimozhi Karunanidhi. A Rajya Sabha MP, Ms. Kanimozhi is also secretary of the DMK Women's Wing and dedicated to the cause of the marginalized. Her numerous poetry collections have been translated to English, Italian, Malayalam, Kannada, Telugu, and German, and she has translated the works of various Tamil poets to English. Moderating this session is Mr. Ram, chairman of the Hindu Publishing Group and former editor-in-chief and publisher of the Hindu and Group newspapers. He's written on a range of sociopolitical subjects and specialized in investigative journalism. His book, Why Scams Are Here to Stay, Understanding Political Corruption in India, was published in 2017. Last week, Mr. Ram was appointed president of the Alliance for Media Freedom, an advocacy and action group dedicated to the cause of media freedom, media independence, and the safety of the last journalists. Sir, I request all of you to please come up on stage and take this session forward.
Good morning. As you can see, the theme of this session is the Dravidian ideology in praxis. And we see it as a homage to an outstanding statesman, Kalaignar Karunanidhi. And we have Kanimozhi and Dr. Ezhilan. I would add that Dr. Ezhilan interacted as a consultant physician at Kaveri Hospital, and as somebody who had known the leader, they were close over three generations from his childhood. He knew Kalaignar, and interacted with him very closely from 2011 as a physician himself. And I think they had many late night conversations. And Kanimozhi, I'm also going to ask her about how he was as a father, his softer side, and so on. Kalaignar was clearly India's senior most statesman with a legendary reputation for longevity, versatility, and fighting spirit. And the records he has set in the political field are not going to be equaled or surpassed by anyone in the conceivable future. It's hard to imagine Kalaignar as a boy of 14, but that was precisely what he was when he entered politics 9 years before India attained independence. No one else, to my knowledge, has led a party for as long as he did, because he became the unchallenged leader, occasionally challenged, but unchallenged mainly, of the Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam following the death of Chief Minister C.N. Annadurai, known as Anna, in February 1969. He was Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu 5 times. And uniquely among Indian politicians, he won his seat in every election that he contested. His legislative career spanned 6 decades, 60 years. And his rhetorical skills, marked by eloquence, erudition, literary allusion, irony, and a sense of history, have been a major asset to his party and the Dravidian movement, in much the same way that Atal Bihari Vajpayee's eloquence and literary flourish served his party over the long term. There may be a few other examples, but I don't think I know anyone who so dominated the field in a cultural sense. A politician who had a lot of time for ideas, for literature, for history, and of course poetry. And you know, he was a big reader also. And his cultural, literary, and journalistic output over many decades was astonishing, and I think places him in a category different from most other Indian political leaders. There are many things you could say about Kalaignar, the administrator. He was considered decisive. He struck an alliance which in the 60s, in the early 70s, which rendered the so-called National Party, All India Party, the Congress, permanently as a junior partner. I don't know if anyone else has done that. It was a very clever, very shrewd move, and no national party, so-called national party, meaning All India Party, ever aspired again to the position of, to reach the A-League. In Tamil Nadu politics, you can see different leagues. The DMK and AIADMK are in first division. Second division come the other parties, in particular the Congress, but also some of the parties which have risen and declined over the years. But those two have remained constant, and the BJP is not even in the second division, maybe third or fourth or whatever in Tamil Nadu. And I think as a statesman serving his own party and movement, Kalaignar had a major role in bringing this about. We know that he stayed true to some the values he believed in the sense one was state autonomy or state rights federalism, if you like. A party that had once espoused secessionism or separatism evolved and upheld consistently, unlike the AIADMK, I think, state rights and the federal principles. And whenever there was any encroachment on what is known as cooperative federalism in India, or quasi-federalism, if you like, which is in the constitution, Kalaignar led the opposition, the resistance, and so on. Twice, of course, he was dismissed with the fraudulent use of Article 356 of the constitution, citing some reasons once during the emergency and later in the 90s. And I think many of us know this. What was remarkable was, I don't know of many political leaders, maybe very, very few, who while being a full-time politician and discharging numerous responsibilities, was a writer every day, was a journalist and writer every day. I've seen it in action. I've known him from the late 60s, around 69 onwards. And I always regarded him, apart from being a major political leader, as a personal friend, because he was very warm, he was accessible, you could talk to him on the phone or he would call you, and even if he disagreed sharply with you, you had a chance of going and meeting him and he would change his mind. I've seen this myself, but there are two others who have been much closer to him, and that's it. But starting with what has been announced there, the Dravidian ideology in praxis. What is praxis? We had a hard time figuring out what is praxis as opposed to practice. So the definition here is, we got it from a historian in the author's lounge. Praxis is the process by which a theory, lesson, or skill is enacted, embodied, or realized. It may refer to the act of engaging, applying, exercising, realizing, or practicing ideas. So praxis is an ancient Greek word where ideas are important, but how you realize that idea in real life is what it's all about. Apparently, it has elements of theory, but theory is taken seriously. And I think it fits this subject, actually. Because the Dravidian movement, the Dravidian movement's ideology is a serious thing. So the first question I'm going to ask is, what are the essential components of what are called the Dravidian movement?
Thank you, Man. I think Dravidian movement is all about social justice. And I honestly, I think it covers everything. When it comes to an inclusive growth, it addresses self-respect, it addresses caste system and the perils which come with it. It talks about, gender justice. It actually addresses, you cannot say what Dravidian ideology has left out when it comes to, it is what we call today as human rights. I think that is what Dravidian ideology is all about. And it talks, it addresses issues which have, we are used to, we've been faced historically and for centuries together. Women have been treated as second-rate citizens, and there are caste issues, especially in India. So all that the Dravidian ideology addresses, and it talks about inclusive growth, and it talks about scientific temper, it talks about progress and an inclusive progress.
One of the criticisms of the Dravidian ideology as it's evolved is that while it has supported social welfare, trying to ameliorate the poverty and mass deprivation there is, it has not addressed the core issue which comes from neoliberal development, the rise in inequality which figured in yesterday in one of the sessions I listened to. So how would you respond to that? It's done very well with respect to, take the midday meal scheme, or many of the other schemes for which Tamil Nadu is celebrated, occasionally criticized in the press. They say, populism, this and that. But I'm not taking that seriously, because nobody can oppose a midday meal scheme, children who are hungry in school, and so on. But how would you respond to that criticism, that it's not addressed the core of the issue, where inequality is rising all the time, but you are just trying to offer some sops?
Actually, a lot of my friends in the Communist Party, their biggest complaint against DMK is that we've imbibed whatever they fought for. We've taken over what they stood for. And I think one of the ideologies of Dravidian movement has been to address inequality. Inequality in the name of caste, class, both together. And especially when I talk about DMK and our leader, he's always stood by, job opportunities and the responsibility of the government in that. Even during the UPA government and the present government, there have been cases where public sector has been, slowly the government has made decisions to push it over and make it private. But I think the DMK has resisted that very clearly. And yes, we cannot completely stop. We're not China or Russia to say that we cannot have private investments and completely do away with the private sector. But I think the Dravidian ideology and the DMK has always stood for balancing all this. Even when it comes to, health care, or when it comes to education, they've made sure that everybody gets an opportunity. So you cannot really say that, yes, inequality has sharpened now, and I think a lot of the credit goes to the present NDA government, that, the richer are getting, richer. But I think one of the most important things DMK did was, made the buses. Simple things like that. They made it public so that, the poor are not exploited. same thing. It comes to when you talk about health facilities and the insurance scheme which the DMK government brought. I think Kalaignar brought it just to make sure that the, you know, the common person was not exploited. So I think the DMK and the Dravidian ideology has always focused on balancing. It's you know, it did not believe in complete total capitalism.
Can I add on that? Yeah. Especially to the criticism what Ram has given up, especially we are talking about post-90s eras. When you take different segments in this part of the country, the translation of economic benefits to the caste down under is because of the inclusive development approach which was taken in early period, even during Justice Party. So that's why I want to quote Hindu itself in September 11, 2015. 62% of entrepreneurships in Tamil Nadu belong to backward classes and NSST and STs. And among that, women entrepreneurship, this state leads in women entrepreneurship because of property rights given to women during the Kalaignar period. I'll simply describe an anecdote so that youngsters can understand. When you stop at the Tidal Park signal, you see the huge tidal plaque standing, which is a structure which has come up post-90s, post-globalization era. If you see the huge tidal plaque there, you can see Kalaignar there. And you see multiple youngsters coming out of the tidal park, women coming out of the tidal park, belonging to different communities, different social milieu, crossing your signal down under, you can see Kalaignar there. In women empowerment and education to the, all the communities down under. Either side of the road, you can see our same social milieu, Bahujans, from the Hindi heartland, from the cow belt, working under as construction workers in the bridge nearby. I compare these two. I'm surprised. I'm really surprised. I pity my Bahujan worker from the Hindi heartland. Come on, you don't have a Dravidian movement there. You don't have a Kalaignar there. If at all, if you had a Kalaignar, you would have some tidal park. You would have worked in a software industry there. Come addressing one more thing about privatization. Privatization is a central policy of infrastructure and health. So the cost of medical education went up, like huge went up in private medical colleges. So it was Kalaignar in 2006 introduced a scheme called each district will have a government medical college. So that the cost of medical education won't go up. So that's why Tamil Nadu has a maximum number of government medical colleges and it serves the upper classes so that they become doctors. So Kalaignar's strategy is to make sons of soil to become doctors so that they serve the sons of soil. When the people at Delhi are scratching it, it's out to increase the doctor paper population ratio, which is worse, 1 in 15,000, 1 in 12,000 in UP, Madhya Pradesh, and all these thrice BJP ruled states. What is the doctor population ratio in Tamil Nadu? 1 is 250, equivalent to Scandinavian countries of Norway and Sweden. So that is Dravidian movement. That is Anna, that is Kalaignar.
You have not mentioned capitation fees in private colleges, which was allowed to flourish.
So that again, you have to blame the Supreme Court for the TM Pai case and Innamadhar case. Why did you allow private institution of capitation fee? Capitation fee allowment, it's in the center. It's a regulatory problem by the center. It's a financial problem in the center. You have curbs power from all the state, move everything to the center, and you're blaming the state government for not doing that. So why can't we make health and education to the state list? And then we can ask the state government, what you're not regulating or regulating? Okay. When MGR brought in the private education, who opposed in the assembly is Kalaignar, who opposed the privatization of education in the assembly. Hope you remember that.
Well, today we're beyond that. Now, let's go back to your origins. You come from a family where three generations have imbibed the Dravidian movement ideology.
No,
right?
My grandfather was a leftist. He was a founder member of the Communist Party.
Two generations.
When we switched over, we thought the real communism is Dravidian here.
And you have been known to be close to the to Periyar's ideology.
Yeah, very much.
The DK.
That's a quote for even Kalaignar also.
Let me finish. What has disappointed you about the, if anything, about the implementation of the Dravidian movement ideology over time?
Okay. The disappointment comes from the origin of ADMK from DMK. The first disappointment. People here fail to understand who is the real oppressor and who is the ruler of the oppressor. I'll take the famous anecdote of Kalaignar itself. When Kalaignar introduced the Kannoli Thittam for eradication of cataract surgeries, a German eye expert, Searsberg, traveled down. He understood how we were able to do the mobile eye camps and eradicate 3 lakh cataract surgeries in one shift. Then Kalang gave to say, people got their vision and they voted for ADMK. See, the populistic schemes came in. Actually, ADMK was started in order to keep down DMK. That is one downfall. So when ADMK came to the picture, when the populistic approach came to the picture, naturally, you have some dilution. Some dilution happened at the first point. And second, after arrival of Jayalalitha, where the concept of self-respect on the peril, where the concept of democracy is under the peril, when the, as you said, no, we can engage with Kalaignar, especially I would question my media friends, when they're going to ask a question to Kalaignar, they can raise the mic like this. But at the same press media, if they go to Jayalalitha, they have to stand, madam, one question, madam. Please, excuse me, madam, one question. They would have a widened distance before asking any questions. So the self-respect movement had a dilution after origin of ADMK, one. Okay. And then second, still this movement is persisting among the youngsters. You see a lot of youngsters today are speaking about Dravidian ideology, Dravidian discussions, various platforms. And we had a big rally also recently in Tirchi. Around 2 lakh, 3 lakh, 4 lakh people, black shirt revolution movement. Again, they gave a message to the BJP. That's why any state, even in Kerala, BJP can do a protest. But they can't bring a single councillor seat in Tamil Nadu because of Dravidian movement.
I'm going to ask Kani about language, the language issue. As I don't know if the younger people here know that there was an anti-Hindi agitation. I was in college then. It made a huge difference. It was a watershed moment.
Looks like it's time for another one.
But the idea that all major Indian languages are national languages, and you can't impose Hindi. I don't think your father had any hatred for Hindi, but...
He did not have any hatred for any language,
yeah,
including Sanskrit.
But the contribute, yes, including Sanskrit, which... but the contributions made particularly by Anna and Kalaignar to the development of the Tamil language, they were deeply immersed in classical Tamil literature, but also in a way helped modernize it. They gave it a political vocabulary, new phrases, colorful phrases. You know, they had their strengths. How do you see this development, and are you really proud of this, the way Tamil has evolved? I won't claim more than other languages, that would be chauvinistic, but that's possible, possibly true, that a lot is going on in Tamil, including contemporary Tamil. So what is the real contribution to, apart from Semmori Manad, what is the real contribution of Chief Minister Annadurai and Kalaignar to the language question?
I think one thing, the DMK specifically and many of the Dravidian leaders did is that they brought Tamil down to, they made it very approachable to the common person. The speech, and they brought in so many, like, I'm surprised when I go back and read and listen to Anna's speeches and many of the Dravidian leaders. They shared whatever they read. They did not say the common man cannot, or woman cannot understand these issues. They spoke about Greek history, they spoke about Roman history, they shared about everything they read. And they spoke about Sangam literature. So they took away all these distances between Tamil and the common person. And they brought poetry to the people. I think that is where, you know, the love for your language, your identity with the language. And I mean, I think for everybody, language is part of your identity. You cannot take that away, and we have to learn to understand that language is part of us, and that is our identity. I think the major contribution by the Dravidian leaders and Anna and Kalaignar was, you know, to a large extent that. And whatever they wrote, I mean, yes, there are two ways of looking at it. You can call it propaganda, but they were very clear that literature or writing or any form of art which does not convey something, which does not talk about some issue, is pointless. This was the Dravidian ideology and their stand about art and literature. They were very clear about it. So they used poetry, music or theater, films, everything as a vehicle to convey what they believed in. And they used it as a vehicle to see the change they wanted to bring into society. I can't think of a Parasakti coming today. But, I mean, they did not have any hesitation. They brought in a lot of freedom of expression. They brought in a lot of dialogue when they spoke about issues like that. I mean, I'm actually digressing from your question, but I really think a very sad thing has happened today. We had Periyar. Can actually somebody like Periyar speak today? I mean, I would be really worried for his life. Any of the Dravidian leaders, they had a chance to create a dialogue. Today, I cannot say something which I believe in. I'm not holding a gun to your head and saying, I mean, like many people do today, and say that you have to believe in what I'm saying. Dravidian politics, Dravidian parties, they did not, I mean, at least Periyar and... they said, they were atheists, they were rationalists. They said, you don't have to go to the temples. Stop going to the temple. I mean, they did not believe in religion. But they were the ones who fought for the rights of the Dalits and the untouchables to enter temples. But today, the case is completely different. So they could create that dialogue, that healthy dialogue between your ideologies and stand for fighting for your rights. Today we can't even discuss women going into Sabarimala. You looked at as an anti-national, Naxalite. And it's the same people who say that they are spreading Hinduism, who say that women, who are stopping people from coming into the temples. And I think, they brought back that pride of language. I think it's more than, and much more has to be done. Of course, Tamil today is there, and I think Kalaignar played a major part in bringing Tamil into, you know, bringing it into the modern world and into the net.
Yeah, I won't add on that.
Just 1 minute. I have a follow-up on this. After you.
Yeah. Into the net and modernizing it. But then, of course, I think the way we teach Tamil, I think a lot is there, you know, to be desired in that, how we take it to our children.
Now, freedom of expression was mentioned, and in particular, Sabarimala. Yesterday, you heard Arun Shauri. I don't know how many of you heard him on Sabarimala and saying, if a deity can't resist this temptation, after seeing a woman between 10 and 50, what kind of deity is that? Sort of, he raised it boldly. Now, I would bet that if Kalaignar had been with us today, yes, you could not stop him from writing on this subject. He wouldn't wound
true,
people's
very
feelings.
Very true.
I think he consciously avoided her, I mean, particularly as he gained experience and became older. I've noticed it. He was careful not to hurt people's sentiments. That's a fact. But you couldn't have stopped him from coming out on this issue, and with his well-known gifts of irony, satire, subtle also, I think he would have taken it on. And you had that kind of thing yesterday with Arun Shauri, very open.
I would slightly differ on that. See, I mean, as age increases, he didn't become soft. When people are talking about cloning of Lord Ganesha, and people are talking about test tube babies of Gaurabas, Kalaignar, during the Sedu Sampradaya project, questioned Where did Ram learn his engineering? Yeah. Which college does he learn from?
Yeah, good question.
So during his age, he became more aggressive. Adding to the Tamil thing, right? I had a lot of students from various states, especially from Marathi. Marathi people said that we were the founders of modern cinema. What happened to the Marathi cinema now? It is destroyed. But what happened to Tamil cinema here? It's persist. It is stronger. It's because of the Dravidian movement. One more anecdote I would like to add. Here, the classical language, yes. But here, Dravidian movement wrote about the commoners. So if you see the linguistic movement other states, especially the Maratha movement, if they have coupled with the progressive movement of Pule and Ambedkar, the state would have been more progressive. It has become like an Hindutva state. Imagine, go to Andhra, the linguistic movement of Andhra. NTR has to travel in the form of Lord Krishna and Lord Rama because in the movies he used to appear. Here, Dravidian movement coupled scientific temper, rationalism, along with Tamil modernity, and that's the success rate of it. And one more thing I want to add in Tamil modernity era. Valluvar was the prototype of Kalaignar's rule, Thiruvalluvar. He didn't take up historical, mythological myths, Lord Rama or Lord Krishna. He took up Thiruvalluvar. That's why we had 133 feet of statue of Thiruvalluvar, overraising Vivekananda statue to say to this country that we are based on virtue, that we are based on scientific temper, and we are based on secularism. And that's the message of Kalaignar through Valluvar.
Did Kalaignar believe that Thiruvalluvar was a Jain or Hindu?
Kalaignar believed Thiruvalluvar was an humanist. No, but that's the approach he made. His literal work on Valluvar into Tamil, he said Thiruvalluvar is a humanist.
I think there is clear evidence that Thiruvalluvar was a Jain.
Clear evidence, even Thiruvalluvar was a Buddhist also.
No.
The controversy still
Doctor,
persists.
Let's not dabble in gossip and so on. Let's be serious on this.
But one more thing. But Thiruvalluvar is an outcast. That's why he was resisted in Haridwara. And we have a huge statue here. That you have to understand.
No, I'm asking not for your views, but Kalaignar's views, as communicated.
Kalaignar's views, yes. He said he's a humanist. But he wanted to translate as what Thiruvalluvar did. See, there are many, many translation work of Valluvar, especially the meaning description of Valluvar in various aspects. Kalaignar was very clean that you should give what Valluvar wrote. That is true.
Good.
That is true.
Okay.
He gave the description on that.
Kalaignar was a genius in managing his time. Much as this has been written about, how he got up early. And before you started your day,
you knew how early he got up. You must have got one of those calls in the morning at 5:30.
Yes. Yes. But as a daughter, how did he manage his time? How much did he sleep? I'm going to ask him later because they stayed up very late, Dr. Ezhilan, and he became a friend. And against medical advice, Kalaignar would stay up till what 2 o'clock and all that. But before we come to that. How do you manage your time doing so many things, administrator or leader of the opposition? How did he prepare himself for it, and how was that discipline or what?
I actually really don't understand how he managed that. And there's one question everybody assumes and asks me that your father wouldn't have found time for you. There's nothing which can be far from the truth. He always found time for everything, and I really don't understand how time extended, how the day extended for him. He had time to talk to his party people. He had time to, go to the Arivalayam. He had time to go to Murasoli. He got up in the morning at around 5. He needed his papers. By then, he read all his newspapers. And
he would read the Hindu first. I know that. It's a fact.
Yes, I know.
Because to oppose, to resist, it's from Hindu.
No, I know that he read the Hindu first because when I was working in the Hindu, Radha Krishna Akira, he was, put on the DMK beat. And I knew he wouldn't get up before 9. So one day when I got a message from Radha Krishna around 5:30 in the morning, then I called him and I said, what is happening? How come you're up? He says, anyway, your father wakes me up at 5:30 in the morning, so better make a practice of it. And I think all the ministers, like, he used to read the papers and then he'll wake up ministers, collectors, officers and said, this has been reported in this paper and have you read it? And then he'll read some of the most obscure papers or magazines and he'll say, have you seen that? And sometimes I used to tell him that there are only two people who read this paper. One is the proofreader and one is you, don't torture us with it. So, but he found time for everything and I really, you know, I would love to learn how, but there was nothing he didn't have time for. And he wrote every day in Murasoli and then he read the papers. And if you give him a book in the evening, he would have read it by the morning. And I really don't understand how. And it's never been that he's tired or you can't keep him. I mean, I think Dr. Arvindan is here and Edil is here. They both know. Even if he's very sick, at the most, you can keep him at home for 1 or 2 days. Then after that, Dr. Gopal, his personal physician for many years, say, you know, it's better to let him go. Otherwise, you know, the tantrums he throws, it's very difficult to handle it.
Now, in public life, he was known to be very tough, relentless, resilient, somebody who could put up with a lot of, you know, setbacks and so on. But in real, but in personal relationships, I got the impression he was a softie. Is that true?
Yes, he valued personal relationships a lot and he could forgive people, I mean, sometimes a little too much. Very easily. I mean, he wouldn't lose a relationship, you know, because some, and he always understood that, you know, people are full of flaws. And he would, and any, I mean, he loved a lot of people, he touched a lot of lives and a lot of people meant a lot to him. So, I mean, if somebody in the party fell sick, he used to call up 10 times to find out how they are and are they better and used to continue calling up the doctors and finding
out. And you'd get emotional and even cry.
Yes. Like when MGR died, I mean, he was devastated. I think for 2 days he was, you know, nobody could console him. And yeah, I mean, he was a very emotional person and he was emotional even in politics. You know, when it, something which went against what he believed in, you know, ideology. It was not always that he, you know, thought about it. He has responded many times very emotionally, you know, which I don't think many politicians would do these days.
But, now, before I throw open the session to questions from you, there's been the criticism, we can take it on later also, that, you know, a movement...
Sorry, before that, I would like you to share something because you've, you know, as a journalist, as a friend, you know, some. I mean, you've had so many conversations and...
Yes, I, very briefly, I think I've known him as a young reporter. He was very kind. I've criticized him. I remember one occasion when there was a tragic incident in Madurai. He wrote a very strong editorial. So he called me very early and said, "Nee ipdi ezhuditinga idu neenga sonnadha dhaan naan pannitena." That is, why have you written so angrily? And I've done what you have advocated. We asked for a CBI inquiry. I don't want to go to the details. So I said, now, the way to diffuse it, I said, I'll come and see you. So you go immediately and see him and the whole game, the whole conversation changes and it becomes very practical. He'll get into a new area and so on. On Sri Lanka, I really valued his position. He had tremendous sympathy for the Tamils. But I think being a statesman, I think he would have been quite satisfied with the best that the Tamils would get. Although the commitment was to Tamil Eelam, he was not dogmatic about it, nor was MGR or Jayalalitha. You know MGR's role in this. There was something, there was rhetoric on public platforms and also real politic here, and they really cooperated with the government of India. They did their best, but unfortunately, the LTTE did not play its cards well. It went all out or nothing, and it lost the game. At the end of it, what happened? Had they listened to the council, I don't know what all the details, but I know this for a fact, that whatever was good for the Tamil people, whatever you could achieve in real life, in a sense, it bears comparison with giving up the secessionist slogan and going for state rights, state autonomy, federalism, or even a confederal scheme and so on. But on Sri Lanka, I know you have a different position on this. you are more dogmatic than Kalaignar ever was. But as chief minister, I think he did his best. And this we greatly appreciate, that whenever civilians were killed, and then it's not that he had no problem with the LTTE. He has gone on record about the brutal killing of Sri Sabharatnam. Kalaignar has told me he was like my brother. I asked baby Subramaniam to intervene, at least save his life. He knew that they had tortured him horribly and killed him and so on. So once I remember discussing this, I said this is wrongly attributed to Napoleon, this statement. It's probably Talleyrand or somebody who said, worse than a crime, a blunder. Worse than a crime, a blunder. Of course, assassinating somebody is a crime, but more than it being a crime, it is a blunder. And I had an interesting conversation with him on what went wrong and what might have been had they not made these blunders, which were worse than crimes. So on all these subjects, I think he was very open-minded, but without ever diluting his commitment to the welfare of the Sri Lankan Tamils. I think that was remarkable. And actually, Tamil Nadu leaders, despite the political rhetoric, I think handled the situation responsibly, soberly, and in a way that could have made a real difference had the LTTE taken a different stand. There was a lot of heroism in their fight, and so on. So I think,
What board it is?
Oh, we're going to run out of time. So questions, maybe three or four questions, but be very specific.
Sir, I have two questions, sir.
No, one question.
But related only. First to
then
Madam,
ask it as one.
Madam Kanimozhi, for 70, 80 years, this Dravidian movement is going on. We are all benefit of the Dravidian movement. But unfortunately, of recent, that is what is called Tamil nationalism. They are putting this Tamil nationalism against Dravidian and Tamil conflict. And they went go to the even telling Periyar, Kalaignar, they are not even Tamilians. They have not done anything to Tamil people. That is what widely they are thinking. How DMK are going to face this? In the name of Tamil movement, that is movement is against Periyar and Kalaignar. That I want the first question. The second question, that emerging Hindu nationalism for Dr. Ezhilan is very rampant. Even I'm afraid that Hindu nationalism will take over even Dravidian movement. That is my personal, I'm afraid. How DMK is going to face this? How Tamil people going to face this? Two different.
Shall we go for Tamil or Hindu nationalism? So shall I start from the center?
Briefly.
Very briefly. Yes. So one thing we have to very well understand. Delhi is against India. The center is against India. Especially the central union government with this Hindu national populism, it's a conglomeration of the bureaucracy, conglomeration of the political parties, irrespective of Congress or BJP. They have left this Hindu nationalism allowed to grow. They have never resisted in the northern belt. Congress, we expected Congress to do that role of Hindu nationalism, but it paves way, because Rahul Gandhi have to say himself that he belongs to a priestly class to win another election. So the Hindu nationalism is perpetuated there. Regarding coming to DMK, DMK is only a resistant force in a political platform. Social platform, we have strong organizations. Cultural platform, we have a strong organization. But in political platform, the only strong basement is only DMK to resist that. For that, Madam Kanimozhi and their leader should work out how to nurture youngsters, what they did going to the back to the basics. What did Anna did? What did Kalaignar did? They spoke about rationalism, scientific temper, regional autonomy, state rights, social justice programs.
So, history.
Yeah, and the revamping is essential and revamping is crucial. So back to the basics. Now the RSS and BJP are going to the back to the basics. So we have to go to the back to the basics, invite youngsters, recruit them to fight against it.
I think Dravidian ideology is about being inclusive, bringing people together. And I'm not talking about everybody, but a lot of people who talk about Tamil nationalism are doing exactly what the BJP is doing. They are alienating people, they are dividing people in the name of Tamil nationalism. And I don't think it can really, like, in Tamil Nadu. I think there's no space for Hindutva, there's no space for the divisive forces. I think the Dravidian movement has had its critics, you know, continuously. And this is part of it. It doesn't matter if Periyar is Tamil, he was born Tamil or not. What he did for the Tamils is what has stood till today, and I don't think there's a better Tamilian than Periyar. So these people who talk about Tamil nationalism have no right to say anything against it.
As a doctor, I'm familiar with the word praxis, because we have the opposite, apraxia, where you have normal power but the inability to perform a function like dressing. In a sense, the question I have for both the panelists is, both Mahatma Gandhi, when he evoked the concept of Swaraj, and Periyar, when he evoked social justice, struck a chord with the common man. They could make it their cause. And so it wasn't just a limited number of people who felt that way. Majority of people started to feel that way. I sense an ideological praxis, apraxia, at this point in time. So what will get people together and strike that chord that there is a need for a movement that will make this country better?
See, I will answer that. See, Periyar movement, we should understand on the basis that this society is a graded system of inequalities based on birth, based on caste, in all spectrums of life, socially, politically, culturally. The resistant movements to that are the progressive movements here. I would term any other progressive movements is null and void, especially the movement which resisted this caste discrimination in various spheres. And Periyar was provoked. Periyar was provoked, so he was able to, he was provoked by the Congress policies, he started the self-respect movement, he was provoked by the culture, society, which is prevalent. Now this provocation is quite essential for Tamil public to wake up. And we are provoked substantially. We are provoked by the imposition. We are provoked by the religious fundamentalism. We are provoked the anti-social justice program implemented by the center without consulting in the state. We are provoked, they are tampering the constitution. We are provoked where the federal structure is destroyed and unit structure constitution is gone. This provocation is essential for the Tamil society. They are provoked. All you used to do is what you say, a detonator is necessary. And if the detonator is given appropriately, naturally, it may evolve into a United States of India, are much more stronger, maybe a Republic of South India, maybe.
Anything to add?
Yeah, I think yesterday also this question was raised, which is more important, governance or ideology? I think we have to understand that, you know, winning an election is not just the point. It's much more than that. Everybody has to realize that if you give up on your ideology, if you compromise on your ideology, then everything is lost. So that is what was the basis of the Dravidian movement. That is what Periyar stood for. I mean, he did not even go into electoral politics. And I think the DMK also was, and the leaders, the founding leaders of DMK believe strongly that they cannot give up on what they believed in, their basic principles and their ideologies for anything. I think if we go back to that, we will touch a chord and we will continue.
One final question. Yes. One. Man, it must be a question.
Dravidian, yes, it means only Tamil. Does it not include the whole of South India?
Yes, it does.
Are not the other languages all Dravidian languages?
Yes.
Why you are not thinking in terms of the whole of South India?
Pardon?
Why you are not thinking in terms of the whole of South India? I was just going through the review
Sorry to interrupt, but when they asked for Dravidanadu, they were asked for whole of South India. It was not only for Tamil Nadu.
Yes, that seems, but discussion it is always almost confined to Tamil and Tamilians. I was going through the review of Mr. Rajamohan Gandhi's book, Modern South India, where he said that the South India is not thinking in terms of throwing a ladder up to Delhi. It happened in the case of Andhra Pradesh, P.V. Narasamy became the PM. We are not thinking in terms of throwing up a good leader. He will lead India at the Prime Minister's level. We are now bogged down in so many petty disputes, river disputes at this and that. We are not thinking in terms of the whole of South India. That is not happening anywhere.
I want to make this point. The DMK is unique among strong regional parties, which has always been clear that it wants to. Its concern is mainly Tamil Nadu. It has a role all India, but I don't think any major DMK leader aspired to the top job at the center. Unlike AIADMK, unlike many of the other parties, they were given a chance. They were clear in their sights. Is that correct?
Yes, when our leader Kalaignar was, when the leaders there insisted that he become the president of India, he said, my heart and soul is here. I mean, he didn't say soul, sorry.
Okay.
No, I have to answer last. The 15th Finance Commission came up, the letter of LOR. When the 15th Financial Commission came in, it was very obvious that we control population and their central is punishing us regarding financial devolution. Kerala Chief Minister, Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, Telangana, except for the slavery government here, the opposition leader joined together, put up a word. We have strong opposition to the 15th Finance Commission. I think that would be a starting point for your question.
Sound like a propagandist.
It's Kalaignar's doctor. We are propagandists.
We got some insights. If you have more time, you can ask him about their late night conversations. Where going against medical advice and his own advice, he kept Kalaignar kept him talking over cups of coffee late in the night from 2011. But that's for another time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, dear panelists, for sharing your thoughts with us. You can throw more questions at them during the book signing and interaction outside the venue. We'll begin the next session right away.
We've taken time for the next session. Sorry about that.
It's okay.